show a couple of things that I do to make a bunch of repetitive cuts of the same size. So like over here, I've got quite a few of the same boards, like 125 inch, 142 inch, where I have to cut, you know, 30, 40 pieces that are all the same size, and it just doesn't make any sense to measure each one, mark it, and then cut it. That would just take forever. So what I did was I got my bench and I just pulled it over here, got it up levels, you know, just put a board across until it was level with the top of my table of the miter saw. And then I put down a board, just clamped it down so that also is at the same angle as my table saw's fence, at least close. It doesn't have to be absolutely perfect, it just helps to line everything up better. And then I got this little 2x4 here and I just screwed it in, just toenailed it in to that board, and then clamped it down. I just bent it until it was a right angle, aligned with that board. And then I just took all my 12-foot boards, set it up there, and my table saw can move. I just have these little clamps here, just pull up on them, and I can slide this over. So I get it close, you know, around 145 inches or whatever my cut's gonna be, and then I can just move my table saw to the right or the left until I get it to whatever my measurement it is that I'm cutting. Like, those are 142 inches. And so then I can just put my boards up here, and I can put two at a time and be absolutely certain that they're going to be accurate. I just butt them up together, butt them into the end there, and cut. Since this is a sliding compound saw, you could actually do, I think I fit eight boards up here all at the same time and could cut across all of them. It's just not as accurate because obviously if that board out there is even slightly off just by a 16th of an inch or an eighth, it can, you know, mess up your measurement. And when you're cutting studs, you really want it all to be as accurate as possible so you're not fighting with the wood. But then the other thing is so that works for, you know, long boards when you're cutting, you know, 142 inch studs. But then I've got a bunch of cripple studs that I've got to cut. And so these little arms on the table work great for that. They extend out, you know, to support the material. But if you raise them up higher, piece of wood, if you raise them up so that the board butts into it, then you've got an accurate little jig that you've made. So see, this board has already been cut, but you see, just butt it up, it is going to make it so I can just put my boards up here and cut whatever size. These are all 33 inch studs. It's for my windows because my windows are 36 inches off the ground, so 33 plus another 3. So I can make a ton of repetitive cuts using that, and then it's really easy to change it. You just unscrew this, move it forward, backwards, for whatever measurement you're doing. I mark a board first, and then I put it up here, and then I push it in or out to the mark on my board and cut it so I know it's accurate. And then I just check every, you know, 4 or 5 cuts, I check a board to make sure that it's still on level, because, or after I hit this, like if I ram a board up against this and I hit it, even though these things are, you know, pretty tight on there, you can still twist these things out of alignment. So if you hit it, or every 4 or 5 boards you cut, just check it and just make sure, you know, check your board, make sure that it's still at the measurement that you had earlier. But yeah, so those are just some ways that you can make some repetitive cuts. It's not too difficult to set up a little jig to do that. And it's especially worth it if you're cutting, you know, 60 boards that are all going to be the same. But it can even be helpful, especially with small boards, just to do that. It does not take very long, and it cuts your time measuring and cutting by probably about 70%. So yeah, just some things that I do. And if anyone else has any tips that they've got, please post it in the comments. We're up here framing the walls. Didn't take a video of the actual frame itself. So you can see we've got these little metal straps, structural straps, there at each corner. They really don't do any good because the OSB provides this structural stability, so I didn't do it on the other wall. What I really wanted was some actual metal strapping. It's about 1 1/4 inch thick, and it goes from corner to corner, and it kind of wraps around on the top plate, the double top plate. And that's what I was really hoping for, but they didn't have it in any of the big box stores that we were looking. So anyways, we're sheathing here on the deck, putting glue down, just using some green guard stuff. This is one that's all sheathed all the way up, and you can see we've got overhang here for the OSB. Since this is going to be, you know, the slope of the roof coming up, we're leaving the excess on there because it doesn't really matter. When we lift this thing up, it'll be nice to already have that sheathing up there. And then when I go to put my studs, the little cripple studs that are going to go up for when I put my joists over the roof for the overhang, you know, that'll also keep them straight up and down. And then I can just cut it off to the angle of whatever the roof is once it's up there. So yeah, that just seemed like the easiest. So yeah, we're gluing down. Let's see, this is the glue we're using. It's just a subfloor and wall adhesive. Subfloor and deck construction adhesive, but yeah, it can be used on walls as well. But it's Green Guard certified, so that means it has lower VOCs than other nails. We're gonna lift these walls once we put the other two sheathing panels on that one. We're gonna lift them up into place to get them out of the way, and then we'll have this whole deck surface to be able to do our end walls. Yay. Once we do, or our side walls. Once we do that, then we can tie them together, put down the top blade, and you know, begin making the walls straight. Also, we've got excess on this deck so that we have all this space to build on, but before we lift up the walls, we're gonna cut it all off. So right now we have connected all the walls together, well, at least this side. We only have sheathing on the first row just because it was too heavy. Now that wall we could do. But these other walls, for one thing, our deck is only 144 inches, 12 feet. But then I have to cut off the excess because it's really only 9 feet, 4 inches. So 112 inches. So I had to cut off the excess before I raised the walls, you know, to put it correctly over the side, the right distance. And so anyways, these walls would have been really tall. We would have been standing off right over here trying to get it up on ladders. And anyways, 16 feet by 12, it's a 12 foot tall wall. That would have been just too heavy with sheathing, so we just put the first row of sheathing on there, just because that would have been easier. And we left the last row off because I didn't want to have to mess with calculating what it would be for this little section we put in here. So it's a 16 foot section, and an 8 foot section combined. 12 foot high on this side, and then these walls are all 129.5 inches tall. And so you can see there, we've got excess, but the roof is going, the pitch of the roof is going to be from here going up to the top there, and that's going to be the pitch. It's a very shallow pitch, only a 212 pitch, so we can maximize our headroom up there. So it'll be about 5 foot high on this side, and about, I don't quite remember what it was, but it was, let's see, 60 inches and 43 inches, I believe, on this side, so almost 4 feet tall. So the staircase is going to be going up right here. It starts right here. This is where the staircase landing is, and it goes up. And so we have the staircase on the high side of the wall so that you have a little bit more headroom when you're going up to the loft. Instead of putting, we were originally going to put the staircase on this side, but you wouldn't have had as much space walking up. So these are the walls. We did traditional framing. So we've got everything 16 inches on center, and so, you know, just mark which one becomes a cripple stud or a jack stud or whatever. But I've got my jack stud going up to the header, and then a cripple going up above it to apply equal pressure all the way up. A king stud right next to that, and then a cripple underneath the sill plate. And yeah, and then up here I didn't put, you know, obviously cripples in this area because there's already, as long as there's one on each of the outsides, then these are just 16 inches on center, following the 16 inches on center for each stud going through. So basically it was mapping out the 16 inches on center and then figuring out where all my windows were going to be. Like, this is where the laundry room is, this is the bedroom window, this is a loft window. I purposely did not stack the loft window on top of another window so that I wouldn't have a header and then cripple going up to another, you know, open window with another header. That just, there's too many cuts in that, and I would just be worried that over time there'd be even, you know, a quarter inch of a sag because the joints aren't perfect or because of sagging, just because that's what wood does, shrinkage. Could cause these windows to not open properly. So I wanted to make sure all the windows had their own jack stud and king stud. So that's why that window's right there instead of on top of this one. You save on wood. If you do it the other way, if I were to have stacked them on top of each other, I would have saved wood and also would have had less thermal bridging. But more worried about being up on a trailer and having everything sagging than I would be about the thermal breaking that would go on. So yeah, so we've got these walls up. We just have to do these now, right across here. Hey, señor, ¿cómo está? ¿Cómo fue el trabajo?
So we are inside the tiny house, big tiny house. So I'm standing at the far end of the living room. No, we're not being abducted by aliens, that's just a tarp. And might have a little bit of a hard time adjusting, but this is the living room. It's got three 48 inch windows in it. We're talking about possibly putting a couple of little picture windows right up in here, or yeah, little non-opening windows right above that main one. So this is the living room. We'll have a couch on this side, an L-shaped couch with possibly a bench right here. Front door, countertop, the sink goes right underneath this window. This is the beginning of the staircase going up. So there'll be a staircase right here. This window right here is for the laundry room. That's for the bathroom, and then this is back here in the bedroom. Those two windows will be in the bedroom, and then these are all loft windows. So the loft is gonna start about right here and come across. We're doing what's called balloon framing, so instead of building your first story and putting a top plate, you know, double top plate, and then building your second story foundation on top of that, laying your subfloor, and then building the second story studs with the roof on top of that. We just did the entire wall here. So that adds to the strength of the structure because it's not a cut joist, you know, with a floor and then, you know, more above it. I just wanted it to be stronger. So this is the way that I decided to do that. But then we're going to put blocks down in between these stud cavities and then set the joists on top going across. And that'll be the second story foundation. So as far as framing this out, the difficulty of doing this though, obviously, is that you can see the wall is so high, it would have been sticking over the edge of the trailer. So that's why, if you remember in the previous videos, I had an overhang that I left on either side. And that just gave us a little bit more platform to work on. But so first we built these end walls, this wall and the one behind me. Built those end walls so we could just lift them up and be done with them. They'd be out of the way. Then we built this wall and this wall. and we lifted up that wall first and then this wall, connected them together. Right here, this is the double joist connection, and so we've just got them nailed together with some screws as well. And then we built this, so that those were two 16-foot sections, or rather one was 15 feet, 11 and a quarter inch, and one was 16 feet. That was just to keep everything 16 inches on center. Then we built this little, you know, this little two joist holding this little 8-foot section in place. After we had done all those walls, sections of the wall, 1, 2, 3, and gotten those up, we connected them obviously to our end walls. So now that was all sturdy and standing, and we started on this side. On this side, we laid out all of our joists, or our studs, all out at the same time, and framed it all together while it was laying there on the deck. We framed it so that it was actually backwards. So the way I had it in my drawing was how you see it here. If you were on the outside of the house looking at the house, that's how my drawing was laid out. But what we had to do was we had to lay it down. Basically, if you take this wall, the way it's standing right now, and lay it down like that, that's how we had to frame it, so that we could pull it out and lift it up. Or rather, we lifted it up and then drug it out. So we had to do things a little backwards, so it was a little confusing, you know, because you're kind of doing it in reverse, because, you know, we're standing on it, looking down at it, you know, putting it together, when the instructions show you looking, or my design shows you looking from the outside. But anyways, got all that together and lifted that up into place. And then, obviously, we didn't put any sheathing on it when we were framing it. So we just got it up into place. So this one also has three sections. Trying to remember, this one was not done the same way as the first one, but right here is the joint. So I think the first panel was probably 16 feet, but I think the next one was only like 12, something like that. The reason being because if it was at 16 feet like this one, you see right here is where the double stud is. If you see, if you just go directly across the floor, that would have been, the break would have been right here in the middle of this door. So couldn't do that. So I just brought it over a couple of feet. So this must have been a 14-foot break right here. So I just broke it on this side of the door so that this was all one section here. So we put down subfloor adhesive underneath the entire sill plate to help seal air. So it's all glued down, screwed down, and then there'll be lag bolts also going down into the frame, going around probably about 20 lag bolts going down into the subfloor frame. Trying to think if there's anything else. We've got the roof on, as you guys already saw. We've got the radiant barrier OSB facing down, and then radiant barrier rigid foam with its foil facing up. So we should be good on radiant heat. And yeah, so now what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be mapping out on the floor, drawing on the floor where everything's going. I mean, it's not really all that difficult. Obviously, I've got right here is the end of the, or right there is the end of the staircase. And so I've got to put a wall here, because on that other side is where the washer and dryer, the stacked washer and dryer, are going to be going. So I've got to figure out where the wall lies, and I'm going to be putting a dryer box in so I can do a recessed little opening for the exhaust of the dryer so it doesn't have to stick out so far. And then right over here where the bathroom is, you know, I've got to put down my walls, and then that's also where the bedroom wall goes, right past this window, right about right there. So the bathroom goes right here. Then I'm gonna make sure that my refrigerator and stove are gonna fit with about a 12-inch little divider between the sink and the stove. I mean, part of the countertop. So yeah, I'm just gonna make sure everything's gonna fit, figure out where my plumbing's gonna go, because also when you're building up on a trailer, you know that you can't just make a hole in the floor because you're going to run into your metal runners that are going this way. So I've got to figure that out as well and figure out where the plumbing can actually fit. Hopefully there's not going to be any trouble, but very well could be that my bathtub lines up right on top of a metal runner. It's a very good possibility, seeing how closely spaced that they are. So just got to figure this stuff out, and that's what I'm going to be doing. Yep, it's coming along with a safe coat to stop the off-gassing interiorly.